perspective?
No, not that. Try this one. There. It says I have a section. Would you like to stop sharing the webcam? No, please do not stop. Okay. See, and I will be I need to be the presenter. If is Lynn, who's on the computer, could make me the presenter, please. Jinfang Shu, you're not going to try to download, right?
Yeah. She said that I shouldn't be...
Yeah, better not to, till we upgrade our our DSL speed. Okay. There you go. Okay. Tell me when the requesting Dharma screen pops up, please. Can you see that?
Not yet.
You guys can. It's fine. Not yet. Okay. Oh, the presenter. There. Now it should be. Okay. Tell me when you see it. We had about 30 seconds. Okay, requesting Dharma.
We don't see it yet.
You don't see this? I've got to do this.
Dharma Master, you haven't shared your screen yet, so we only see your webcam and not your desktop.
How about give me 30 seconds and it should pop. Cross your fingers. Is it working? It's working. Tell me it's working.
Not yet.
Okay.
But we have the text in front of us, so we can go ahead and refer to our own text.
This we're doing the Dharma request. I want to be able to share what's on my desktop with you all. So let's go back to the main screen.
Okay, now we see it.
All right, and that's I just clicked it off, which means you I wasn't patient enough. Tell me if you see this.
So right now we are still
are you seeing
we are still seeing Ollie right now.
Uh-huh.
And that was okay.
Well, that's nothing wrong. That's a good thing all by itself. Okay.
They all know about Ollie.
They do know about Ollie. Okay, so can be seeing the Chinese characters Gong Qing Da Da something.
And not yet.
I think the lag is not yet. It's about 30-second lag. I'm asking you to see on my control panel. I've asked for the Dharma request, which is a keynote PowerPoint slide. How about now? If this doesn't work, we're going to not do this and just do the analog.
Still nothing.
That you have. Still nothing, huh?
Still just Ollie.
Okay. Just Ollie. Huh? He's a good bird. All right, and now as soon as I quit last time, it happened. So now I'm going to wait one more time, and you're going to go, oh, but now we see it, Not showing anything. Oh, my control panel says not showing anything. What if I do that show main screen? Does that change anything?
Is there a pause button on your desktop center, Reverend Sure? Because your screen is basically frozen.
I'm wondering if it's frozen.
If you click there's the
open. yourselves? Can you see yourselves? And you can see me. You should be able to see. That's important. Can you see me, just Ali?
Now we see you, and we still see requesting Dharma.
Oh, nice. Because I clicked requesting Dharma off.
I have no idea.
All right, this is, we're chasing our tail.
Yeah, I think it's
okay.
Really slow.
So let's do this. The problem is speed. Okay, so what we're going to do, going to close that. And we're going to simplify it. So we'll take it down to basics so we'll be able to begin. And so the folks here in Gold Coast will not be able to see the text. Oh, yes, you will. I'll just show you guys. I can do that. And then, yeah. Okay, here we go. We'll just do that much. And folks in Berkeley, please refer to your Dharma request sheet. And we will ask Sam, who's here at the incense, to help us do the Dharma request. Okay, so the way we do is we put our palms together. If you're interested in experimenting with that, there's no pressure if you're not comfortable with that. Sam, you want to begin? Okay, Sam has got incense and he's circling now, so we'll request Dharma. Okay, now Sam is going to start us in chanting Chinese request. Gong Jing Da Da San Ting Wei Zi Ba Wei Ji Jian Song Shen Jing Da Da Ba Jiao Da Wu Will the Sangha with great virtue of compassion for the sake of this assembly and all living beings Okay, now I'll give you a line and you give it back to me. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Homage to the blessed, noble, and perfectly enlightened one. Okay, now we'll do the Chinese. Namo Sadanto Suchedoye Olahadi San Miao San Putoye. Okay, for those who can, let's do the Chinese together. Wu Shang Shen Shen Wei Miao Fa I chin one chin on Zhao Yu. Wu jin chin one de shou shi. Yan chi rai chen shi yi. Now together, let's do it in unison. The subtle and profound, screened and wondrous Dharma, rarely is encountered even in a billion eons. But now I see it, hear it, and accept it reverently. I vow to truly understand the Buddha's actual meaning. Oh, that didn't work because we have two different Dharma request verses. So I'm sure you in Berkeley heard it. Okay, we've updated our translation of that Dharma request verse. So we have begun our sutra lecture for tonight. This is the 23rd of August. And in Australia, 22nd of August in Berkeley, California. And this is our third episode of Saturday Night Avatamsaka Sutra Remote. So that is to say, as Dharma host, I'm in Gold Coast, Queensland, in Australia. We're here with Dharma friends, and my challenge is to lecture for you all and let the camera, that's to say everybody in Berkeley, be the yet one more audience member. That was our suggestion, our improvement. We got some really good critique last week, and they said trying to lecture to the camera in Berkeley kind of cut off the chi. So it got lost somewhere around Tierra del Fuego, perhaps, and it didn't quite make it across. So down under didn't go up above, up very successfully. So if I lecture on text to the folks in Gold Coast, people in Berkeley will feel more connected to the chi because it's going to be a real lecture. So that's the plan. We'll see how that works. We're juggling a lot of things, and the fact that we can hear each other and see each other is already, you know, mostly all the way home. Trying to, on top of that, share a text when our screen refresh rate is running about 120 seconds per screen. We had a funny experience last week, which was Jin Feng Shi. By the way, is Laura there tonight? Laura? Oh, don't call her by name. That's going to embarrass her. So anyway, Laura Jinfeng Shi, Laura's sister Jinfeng is here. So anyway, Jinfeng had her laptop open last week here in our room. It was Star Realm. And she was watching the streaming webcast as we were lecturing. And the lag time, what was it, 2 minutes or 3 minutes? 3 minutes. 3 minutes between when I did it here and when she saw it on her computer 6 feet from me. It was very funny. We did the dedication of merit. I put the guitar away, came around and watched myself start the dedication of merit on the computer because what we're doing is just in some of the challenges to how miraculous this really is, amazing it really is here I'm live in Gold Coast. And I'm using just a simple laptop to both audio, my image, and my sounds. We're sending them on the internet to Berkeley, where you guys are doing the same thing. And then there's a computer in Berkeley that is taking signal and webcasting it out to YouTube for our live YouTube channel. So that all has to happen. And then Jennifer had her laptop, and she was watching the webcast on YouTube last week. It was 3 minutes to go to Berkeley and back. So how interesting. Those must be some pretty tired electrons by the time they've run around the globe.
For sure.
But
yes,
sir.
Sorry, this is the tech team. We are having some difficulties with the YouTube stream. Could we please pause for 30 seconds so we can try and fix it?
Let's stop for a commercial break. This webcast, this sutra lecture, is brought to you by Dharma Realm Buddhist University. So, you go ahead. You could open my guitar. So that was the voice of Yan Lin, who is one of our tireless tech team volunteers. Quick, cut to the music. Let me know when you're ready. If you think about, you know, radio was just like that when in the early days. And there's, I want people to understand the complexity of how this is all being, how many moving systems are at work here. One of them is when I was away from Berkeley on a Saturday night, we had to find a stand-in. There had to be somebody else to cover the, because we like to make the sutra lectures continue. That's really a good thing to do, because there's people sitting around reading old books. There's an actual presence of, we say invisibly, the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas and the Dharma protectors come to listen to the sutra. Now, I don't see that, I can't verify it, but it's, there's a sense of that happening. If you're sincere and you do it rufa, according to Dharma. So, what happens, the burden goes on the monks who are on staff. Now, luckily, at Berkeley Monastery right now, we have 3.5 monks who are qualified to lecture. We have the half is Qin Xian, who those of you who saw our video called Leaving Home, that happened just in July. That was Qin Xian's leaving home, shaving his head, going from the status of a layman to novice monk. So he's a monk in training. So we have 3 monks and one in training. Who are technically able to lecture, and in fact, the way Matqua did it, anybody could lecture on a text. You didn't have to depend on your haircut or your outfit to qualify you to lecture. He said, whoever has one part of wisdom explains that one part of wisdom. Whoever has 10 parts of wisdom explains 10 parts. So Sam, we're looking at you. You're getting in line here. So you didn't know that, did you? Oh, no. He looks terrified. So anyway, so technically, one of the systems we have operating here, one of the things going on is Jin Chuan Shi and Jin He Shi and Jin Fo Shi, the three bhikshus, are on staff at BBM, and also Qin Xian, our novice, our Shramanera, are on call. They're I'm doing, but the idea is they're in there studying and learning and practicing, and the idea is that they will be able to step right in, you know, on a week's notice to take their turn to lecture. And so that was how we set it up. And Jin Chuan and Jin He, who was on staff here for 9 months here in Australia, they would lecture together. And then Jin Fo sure would lecture with Jin Fan sure would come down sometimes from CTV. So, in other words, we have two teams of lecturers. And I've been doing this now for, I guess, 30 years. 40 years a monk this August. And in fact, 23rd, 2 days ago was my 40th year as a monk. How about that? I became a bhikshu on August 21st in 1976. So that's something, I guess, 4 decades as a monk. And I've been doing this at least one sutra lectures a week ever since. And I had the blessing to be trained as a translator by my teacher. I sat, Master Hua would be sitting here and the translator would be sitting to the right, and I was one of a team. So I trained him for 18 years on how you traditionally approach a Buddhist text. And that's one of our strengths. And one of the things I wanted to talk about tonight was how significant I think that is, why I think that's really important that we do that. And the short answer is because it's not happening other places very much. We're here at the coast, and turn the screen to the right, you can see the plus. There is a room like this where at least the words the Buddha spoke are collected. Now, the languages they're in is the question. And so Master Hua, our teacher, made it important for us to open the texts and explain for ourselves, as best our wisdom could, what the Buddha was saying. Translate it, put it into other languages, and then circulate it. So that's a big deal. But if you have it even in your own language, but nobody explains it to you, then it's still mute. You're still not hearing anything. So the trick is, the challenge is to let the Buddha's voice be heard. And we've been talking about this for a couple of weeks, some of the difficulties. One of the difficulties that, you know, here we are at Gold Coast, and we have Jin Fang Shi and Sam, we have Julie is here, Tori, and Wendy and Anton, our Dharma friends here who came for the meditation class this morning, and Julie has been here for many, many years, Gold Coast. We have lectures here, and people are used to Chinese being heard and English being heard in sutra lectures. When you go out into the Buddhist world, people who are hearing this for the first time wouldn't imagine some of the other problems that get in the way of hearing the Buddha's voice. And here, there's one. We could actually move this out of the way, couldn't we, Sam? There is one problem. It's a real problem, which is amazing, which is in Buddhist Asia, where these texts have been for 2,000 years, people pretty much don't touch the sutras. They go directly to commentaries. Commentaries are words spoken by some learned monk, mostly sometimes nuns, maybe 1,300 years ago. It's the idea behind it is we can't understand these, so we have to find out what they mean back when. And instead of going to the sutras, people go to the commentaries. And so what you get is the sutra, but with a filter on it. And that filter is the thinking of some wise, lofty, erudite monk 1,300 years ago in the language that was, you know, what learned monks spoke and thought and wrote back then. And it's wonderful stuff. You know, we're not to say it's a problem, but it's filtered through another. And often it's written in a style really kind of like reading Shakespeare, although it's not as much fun. Shakespeare is wonderful, but it's definitely an English we're not used to, right? When was the last time you picked up Shakespeare and read it for recreation? Never. Well, not never. Maybe you did Hamlet in high school. But it's complicated and archaic. It's older. Commentary is that way. So, the point, what's wrong with that? The point is, I had a monk friend, Master Zhen Yi, in Taiwan. And Master Zhen Yi, before he became a monk, was famous for whenever there was a Dharma event in Taiwan, he was there. He had a Volvo, and he would cover the highways in Taiwan going to Dharma assemblies, and he always went. And I said, well, is there any part of the Buddha Dharma that you don't like? He said, I can't stand sutra lectures. He said, I just can't stand, I never go. I said, why not? He said, number one, there aren't many of them. Number two, boring to death. Boring. Just boring. Just like deadly, go to sleep, knock you down, make your eyes glaze over. Boring. Terrible. He said, I don't like that stuff. He said, it's just some lofty philosophical stuff that the Buddha didn't say that. And I was like shocked because that was not my experience. Master Hua's sutra lectures were fun. They were exciting. They made you feel like he was like reviewing your thoughts and then kind of teasing them out so you could see what you were thinking through him and telling you, you know. He would catch up with the news, you know, tell stories. It was, mind you, he was probably babysitting for the brand new monks and nuns. That was a large part of that, trying to keep us entertained. And if we could have understood more, chances are he would have told us more. But they were not boring. And most of all, what I saw was our teacher's attitude towards the Buddha's voice, which was, he said, I want you to hear the Buddha's voice. Your wisdom is enough to understand what he's saying. It's in the sutras, let it be heard. And he would say, we love the commentaries. We had some evidence Hua would review the commentaries before the lecture. You know, he would see what Master Chan Guan said, what Master Fa Zhang said, and then he would maybe make notes, maybe just remember, put it aside, and then he would lecture directly from the text. And we saw him respect the Buddha, and most of all, what I got from him was he wanted people to connect with the text. He wanted us to get it. He really did. It mattered to him that we understood what the Buddha was saying. So he would, you know, give us a paragraph, and then he would say, do you all understand that much? And he would say, anybody have any questions? And he would say, if you don't have any questions, I'm going to ask you questions. You better ask me first, or else I'm going to put you on the spot, which you understand. And then when it was over, he would tell a story to illustrate it. It was like there was an attitude being expressed of love for the Buddha's wisdom, that this was important. He did this for 90 minutes every night for 30 years, without exception. 90 minutes at night, 7:30, sutra time, right? Saturday twice, Sunday twice. So we got like, you know, 7 + 2. We got 9 sutra lectures a week. And that impressed me, and I got to see the sutras as something other than abstract philosophy, which is the attitude a lot in China, and in Korea, and Japan, and Vietnam, and Singapore, and Malaysia. Sutras are too high to understand. So, as I know I told a couple weeks ago, we had a visitor from Japan, at the Berkeley Monastery just 2 months ago, Reverend and he is a very learned monk and a very experienced, skillful teacher of Westerners. He's a Zen teacher. And he was dining room, we're drinking tea, and he said, well, what are you focusing on here? And I said, well, I lecture on this sutra. He said, oh, you do? Which one? I said, the Avatamsaka. He said, why? Why? Why are you doing that? And it was like, well, it's my favorite. I've been focused. I bowed to every word in it. I carried it on my back. I translated it. I, you know, sing songs about it. And he said, but no. He said, that's just like lists of rules, right? He said, our teacher, he and I had the same Zen teacher in Japan. Our teacher, Uchiyama Roshi, used to recite it to go to sleep. He would recite it on purpose because it would make him fall asleep. That was what he used it as a sleeping pill. You know, and you're explaining this? And I said, that's not my experience. There are lists. That's not what we lecture on. And he said, yeah, but it's this stuff about, you know, interpenetrating without obstruction and, you know, the infinite Dharma realm and, you know, chong chong wu jin and the 6 kinds of identity. And I said, I said, you know, Isho-san, Ujita-sensei, this is the problem. And as I explain this, people who have never encountered this, like, what? Why did they let this happen? This is the attitude in Buddhist Asia toward the sutras, which is you don't touch the sutra, you go for the commentary. What he was describing, interpenetrating without obstruction, and the six identities of the Buddha, these are schemes that the Tang Dynasty commentators came up with to summarize the text. And that's what they could write down. And so it's like, what would it be like? It would be like a high school teacher. No, that's sound belittling the commentators. They're not. It would be like the president's science advisor telling you about, instead of reading Einstein's work. Or, you know, Charles Darwin is an exciting writer. Darwin really, as he went out, and he was an artist too. He would write, he'd draw pictures of the flowers he was looking at, the animals, the Galapagos Islands, and he would write he was excited about what he saw, and you get the excitement when you read him. But if instead of reading Darwin's own writing, you read a college textbook on botany, you know, on evolution, you go, okay, it's abstract, right? So here we are, looking into the Avatamsaka Sutra, and there aren't many places around the world on our Sunday, your Saturday night, where people are doing that. And why not? Well, because, two, it's lofty philosophy and you can't understand it. Three, it's full of Sanskrit. We don't do Sanskrit. You know, four, it's in Chinese. We don't do Chinese. So all these reasons why, nobody does it. So here we are. Our text is in Chinese and English. And the Sanskrit is understandable. And the parts that we don't get, I haven't said this before, but I realize this is actually the way I do it is, I have a zero tolerance for terms that aren't explained. If you have to swallow it without understanding it, we went too fast. I think that's really one of my fancies in my mind. You know, the question they ask is, what do you mean by that? What does that mean? I think that should be our approach. And now that I've said all this, we haven't actually touched the sutra yet, but we'll do that next. But I wanted to get that clear. Where I made notes here. Ah, got it. Right there. Okay. So this is both a lecture tonight and also a kind of a seminar in lecturing. What else? We're in a chapter. I'll explain to the folks for whom this is the first experience with this. The Avatamsaka Sutra is a very big text. I'm pointing over here to a bookshelf. It's that entire, all the volumes in one collection, and that's smaller than double size. So it's a big, big, big book. If it was entirely translated in English, it would probably be something like 60 volumes, you know, thick. And it took Master Hua 9 years to do the whole thing, and he did it every night. It started, you know, 9 years of stuff. We are looking at one chapter out of that whole thing. It's one of the bigger chapters. It's called the 10 grounds, the 10 stages. Ground meaning a level, 10 level. And it's called the Dashabhumi in Sanskrit, the Shirdipin in Chinese, the 10 grounds chapter. We are in ground number 6. We're more than halfway through. And what chapter is talking about is, what is a bodhisattva? How do bodhisattvas think? A bodhisattva is an awakened being, someone who's already awake. And yet, this bodhisattva is somebody who could save himself, could save herself already, but chooses not to. They could become a Buddha and be done with all the suffering of coming into, you know, being born, getting old and sick, and dying and being born again. They could quit all that and be gone. They could enter nirvana like a Buddha, but they chose not to. Because bodhisattvas are very soft-hearted, experience other people's pain as their own pain, and they want to find a way to wake them up too. So they postpone their own liberation for the sake of others. That's what a bodhisattva is. If that sounds far away, think about, you know, how do you tell a bodhisattva? You tell about what they do, their conduct, their behavior. And think about, and I don't know everybody's mom, but like my mom, when I was a kid and my diaper maybe had colic, I would cry at night, no matter the hour. If I was unhappy, I would cry. My mother got up and tended to me and took care of my problem till the tears stopped. She did not say, no, it's too late, I'm busy tomorrow, it's your problem, right? Moms don't do that. Moms sacrifice for the sake of their kids. They will feed the kid first and go hungry themselves. You know, I think we all can identify. That's bodhisattva-like behavior. Okay, someone who says, no, your well-being is the same as my well-being. Now, if you aspire, let's say, I want to be more bodhisattva-like, I want to be more unselfish than I am now, I want to be a lot less selfish than I am now, you spend a lot of time with your broken. I was talking, Sam and I were walking to lunch the day, and I had just read on one of my favorite columnists, writes for the San Francisco Chronicle, a guy named Mark Morford. And Mark had written about environmental anxiety. It's now an actual psychological category, neurosis. People who are scared of the impending end, right? And he was right. The latest statistics are that if you were alive and well in the 1960s, in the 2015, there are 40%, was it 40 or was it 60% fewer species on the planet than there were in the 60s. So in the last 50 years, we have, in that tiny 50-year slot, we have put an end to, made extinct, made disappear, more than half of the extinct of the animal and fish and bird and reptile species on the planet. And, you know, I read that, and I read it, and I read it again, I read it like four times, and Morford writes really well, and he says, that's more than just sad. He says, our well-being is tied in the well-being of neighbors on our planet, no matter whether they're species or other species. And when I read that, I could almost feel that reality sink in. And if I were a young parent right now, and I know we have some in the audience, I'm not trying to bum you out. If I had kids or grandkids now, I wouldn't know what to do. Children who are being 20 may well never elephants. I read yesterday that elephant killing in the states of Africa, where the elephants like Malawi and places like that are higher than ever. That in the last 5 or 6 years, there is a race to get the ivory off the elephant and sold, because why? There's a big market in ivory right now. The high prices are good, which means, you know, to go out on the internet with these statements is probably dangerous. But the article that I read said there has to be government involvement. With the rates the elephants are disappearing, the only way that could happen, that they could go so fast, would be if the government were deliberately turning away from the poachers. Because if anybody was trying, they could have at least slowed it down if they were actually seriously trying to stop it. Anyway, so just to say, if you are, you know, if you aspire to be a bodhisattva and you see pain as your pain, you spend a lot of time being brokenhearted. Because when you see, you know, animals are easy targets, because who doesn't love animals? And then when it's people, when it's human beings who are, you know, right now, refugees, the problem of refugees is such a painful, painful reality. This morning in our meditation class, I mentioned that we were about to transfer merit this morning. We're thinking about who to transfer to, and a lot of time people come to meditate and they say, I want to meditate because I want to connect with my roots. I want to find where I belong. You know, where is my place? Where do I belong? Am I? Well, one answer to the question, who am I, is where did I come from? Okay, so let's go find my roots. What if are because of war, because of political reasons, because of increasingly climate reasons, like too dry, no water, forest fire, no food? What if those reasons are pushed off your ancestral roots? So, either you have to run for your life. To survive, you can't be there. You are known as a refugee, right? You're taking refuge somewhere else. How much of the answer to the question, who am I, is bound up in my story? Well, mostly, multiple stories. What do I say about who I am? I know who I am because my grandfather told me who I am. I have learned my grandfather's language. It's not my language. You know, in my case, my grand Quebec French, Quebecois, and as well as respected English. Oh, if my story, who I am, is tied up in the trees, the land, the water, the food, the air, the folks, the relationships, the songs, the music of a place, and then I can't live there, that's a shock. You want your traumas of life, and there you go. Reading about, you know, people arriving in Budapest, Hungary, from Syria, from Yemen, and from these places that are where they have to run. Their homeland is uninhabitable. At least they're not in immediate danger from bombs dropping. But then they get to their new land, and the folks who live there say, I don't know you. You don't know my story. Why are you here? What are you doing here? You know. So pain is right there. That's our world right now. We're overcrowded. We're in a difficult time in our world. So the point is this, all this, we have ample opportunities for bodhisattvas to appear right now. There's no shortage of bodhisattva chance to feel pain. Because what do we do with that? How do we deal with it? Well, there's a point where you get, compassion peak. Your heart just, if you're really paying attention, if you're really noticing what's going on, you can't bear it. I got an email today from a friend whose friend's daughter was sitting in her living room doing her homework, and a spray came in from a drive-by shooting in Oakland and killed her dead. This happened this week. And folks here in Gold Coast, you know, where there might be, what, in all of Australia, 30 handgun-related deaths in a year, maybe. In the U.S., there's 40,000. And a lot of them, you know, 5 miles from where you're all sitting in Berkeley. So, not to bum folks out, not that you Buddhists are all suffering all the time. That's not what we're about. I just wanted to say, you know, we think about transferring merit. A bodhisattva is someone who says, your pain is identical with mine. Your joy is also identical with mine. So, third life. It's much easier to stay self-medicated all the time. You know, you always got a cold one next to you, you know, in a tumbler, and you can turn on, you have infinite numbers of movies and Netflix and lots of ways to, like, numb that awareness. But the Avatamsaka Sutras was our takeout point for this. This is what we pay attention to, is how to survive, how to keep that sensitivity alive in a world where it's almost too much to bear. And the bodhisattva is on deepening his reserves of compassion. We're going to find that out tonight. Okay? Now, we have not done our chanting yet. For the folks here, the front page, you all in Berkeley, if you could open to the front cover of your sutra and get our chanting. And it's right for you guys, right here in Gold Coast. We're going to chant the Chinese that's down below. The translation is above. The melody is in Chinese. So this is an invocation, homage to the Buddha's Flower Garland Sutra of Great Expansive Teachings and the Ocean-Wide Flower Garland Study of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. We're going to chant that. Do we have a petition? No? Okay, fine. Here we go. The Chinese down below, this romanized Chinese. Namo da fa wang fu hua yin ji hua yin hai hui fo pu sa Namo da fa wang fu hua yin ji hua yin hai hui fo pu sa Namo Da Fang Guang Fu Hua Yin Ji Hua Yin Hai Hui Fu Pu Sa Number 4 Namo Da Fang Guang Fu Hua Yin Ji Hua Yin Hai Hui Fu Pu Sa 5 Namo Da Fang Number 6, Namo Da Fang Guang Fu Hua Yin Ji Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. Number 7 in English. Here we go. Ready? Homage to the Buddha's Flower Sutra of Great Expansive Teachings and the Ocean-Wide Flower Garland Assembly of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. Okay, good stuff. Please turn, if you will, to page 23. Here we are. We are down at this bottom paragraph. I think folks in Berkeley should have the same as we have here. Yes. Page 22 is in 23 is the English. Last paragraph that goes, For zi pu sa ru shi guan cha, you wei duo zhu guo huan. That's the one. Okay, now let me give you the Chinese. I'll give you a line and to me, and then we'll do the English in unison. Okay, ready? Here we go. 佛子 菩萨如是 观察为 多诸过患 无有自性 不生不灭 而恒起大悲 不舍众生，记得般若，名无障碍，智慧光。 Great. Okay. Is there a lag, or how does that sound in Berkeley? Is it in sync with the chanting, or is it behind? Good. We're way ahead of you. We've done that. We're being good. We have turned off all our streams. Yes. Great. Well, I just wanted to be sure that there wasn't, if it was a lag, then it's, you're going to hear me ahead of you, and it's going to be a funny state. So I wanted to see if we're more or less in sync. So let's do page 23, Disciples of the Buddha. We're going to do it in unison. Ready? Here we go. Disciples of the Buddha, the Bodhisattva in that way contemplates the conditioned as having many faults and as being without a nature of its own, and so not produced and not destroyed. He constantly gives rise to great compassion and does not forsake sentient beings. Right Prajna Paramita manifests before him, which is called the unobstructed light of wisdom. Okay. Let me restate that. Let's see if we can pin that down, what that might mean. Disciples of the Buddha. This text is being spoken by a bodhisattva himself, not the Buddha. It's the Buddha's voice, the Buddha's energy, infusing a bodhisattva. He's been deputized. And his name is Jingang Tsang Pusa, Treasury of Vajra. He's a treasury of adamantine, diamond-like light. That's his name. He's a speaker. And he is, it's a dialogue. He's talking to an assembly, assuming in the text we have the vision. There was a speaker and a great listening to what he was, and occasionally came to poetry, spoken word poetry, and praise the speaker or praise the Dharma. It's pretty animated. And when this is done with the prose part, we go into verses. So this is going to go in rhymed structures that go bum, 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 bum. Right now, the Buddha, he's declaiming, he's expounding. So, disciples of the Buddha, he says, the Bodhisattva contemplates the conditioned, having many faults and disasters, and yet no nature, therefore it can arise and it does vanish. What in the world is the condition? So the Bodhisattva contemplates is a verb, which means he's looking with his mind. Bodhisattva is reflecting. He's thinking about. The conditioned means everything in the world that we know through our senses. Like in front of me, I have a computer mouse. That's an Apple one button mouse. Laser beam on the bottom. I've got a teacup and a saucer. Let's use the teacup. The teacup is glazed porcelain, and it holds tea. The porcelain is at least sand originally, or clay, I guess. And it was thrown on a wheel or made on a lathe. And the clay was originally earth, the right kind of clay, right kind of, you know, sticky earth. It was put onto a mold and then took the shape that it was in. And it was connected, the handle and the shape. And then it was glazed with some other form of earth-based compound that responds to heat. Then it was painted. Then there was a label put on from the company that is full of tea. Mm-hmm. And it's very pretty. It's you know, white inside and colored outside. Then it was put under extremely high heat. And what came out was called tea mug. So that's the thing. Conditions had to be there before I could drink tea out of it, right? And then you heated up leaves from a plant with hot water and infused them, and I drank it, and I'd get refreshed. Those are conditioned things. The earth, the chemistry, the glaze, the changes that take place with the heat of the kiln, the fire, those are all conditions. Take one of them away, you don't have a teacup. All right? So what is this? This is chemistry class. This is science, basic science. If you think about what you did in your high school chemistry class, what did you analyze stuff? What is this? Took it back to its, took it apart, took it to its component pieces and put it together. Is nice. A computer mouse is obvious. This is manufactured, and probably it will go back to recycled and become not recognizable as a mouse anymore. More immediately is your bodies, right? We're all listening with the body, and the body is this funny contraption of fire and water, and a lot of electrical buzzings keeping us in our, you know, and yet it's changing all the time. We're aging. Our heart is beating. We are going to take something like 24,000 breaths a day. Our digestion is happening. Our sleep cycles are happening. We're either hungry or less hungry or not hungry at all. We're stuffed or we're too hot. We're just right. We're too cold. All of these sensations and balances are taking body, change a little bit of it, and it goes wrong. Illness is that, right? We get sick when something goes out of balance. And just don't eat for a couple of days, and you really confuse. So how amazing is that this body is such a contraption? It's a heap of stuff, and it's a relationship. It's not stable, it's not solid, it's not long-lasting, it's not even clean, the constant upkeep, you know, it's conditioned. Bodhisattva says, he contemplates the condition as having many faults and disasters. In the Chinese, it's not so much that the object itself has disasters. I think the better way to interpret that is, he contemplates how conditions fall apart, the way they come together, and as much as we are attached to them, that's how much we feel, that's how we suffer when it goes away. It's a disaster when we get sick. It's a disaster when we die, right? Guohuan. It's even a disaster when we leave the tea bag in the cup too long. If the tea is thick, it's a disaster, right? So, so, in other words, these relationships go bad easily. That's his point. The Buddha contemplates how the stack of conditions that create the reality that we know is fragile. It's really fragile. Jin Hosher, do you have a? Are you heading with a microphone to somebody who's put their hand up? That's Jin Chuan. Yeah. I was playing with the cord. Are you hearing it now, right this minute? Still the same? Okay, I was playing with the cord and I let's take this away. I've removed the audio. Okay, so let me undo this. This is Sam. Is this the Yeti?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna take that out. Here we go. And plug this back in. This should be there. Can you use it? Oh, now can we take that out of the system?
Yeah.
That's the issue. Yeah. Yeah, can you mute that entirely? Okay, I think we can probably solve that. Okay, how's that working? Is that better? Okay. Okay, nice. Good. Thanks for telling me. Okay, so now that was a false alarm. I saw you stand up and I thought, oh, he's got a question. Roberto has heard me talk about conditioned things and he's going to say something wise. And so David is going to say it first, right? Or somebody, Connie, is going to raise her hand and go, Dharma Master, does that mean, you know? No, she did, see. Thinking it. How did I know that? Give that girl a microphone. So, the unconditioned is a false and disastrous. I'll hit replay. Okay, ready? Here we go. Replay. Okay. Unfortunately, we can only do it in Chinese, so I repeat all of that in Chinese. No, let's see. Okay. No, because why? You didn't hear it? You mean because of the buzzing? Okay. Okay, so we solved that problem. Isn't that nice? We did some troubleshooting, Sam.
Yes.
5 stars. Good. Okay, so what I was doing, I was illustrating what is a conditioned thing. And I was saying dramatically that the body is a conditioned thing. And so the bodhisattva looks at all things and goes, yeah, they fall apart. That's plain English, Rohit Singh. Okay. It's not that contemplates the conditioned as having false masters. No, he says stuff falls apart. He sees it that way. She sees it that way. Think of your relationships, the ones you really care about. They can fall apart too. Our pets, you know, our pets go away. And right now, we have a condition. Let me explain a condition. And today in meditation class, I made a plea for, I need a bird expert, bird sociology, which is what everybody, we like Ollie, right? Here's our favorite kookaburra. Favorite kookaburra. And Ali has not been to see me since I've been back, and Sam and I are trying to, because he lives in the same building, and we're thinking, oh, it's breeding season, he's paying attention to his mate, you know, and he's looking skinny because he's not eating because he's feeding her. We have all these theories, right? And we think it's not that. We think it's that there's two other birds called kurawangs, and kurawangs live right in the trees right next to our house. And they are, like, as soon as I set foot outside, they're landing on the railing, they're looking up at me like this, because I feed them too. And kurawangs have a reputation of chasing away other birds. They take responsibility for any human scene where food is around. And we think maybe they're chasing Ollie away, keeping him away. And yet, in the past, they've coexisted. And, you know, it's fun. I've known this bird for 3 years, and he's a wild bird, but he likes me, and he likes Sam, and he comes. I mean, we feed him in the morning. It's fun. It's nice to see this bird who's got all these expressions, and clearly you can see for his feelings. When he's happy, he's like, you know, and when he's nervous, he's you know. It's fun to interact with this wild being creature who lives here. And we can't now because the kurawangs, we think, are chasing away. So we put out the plea to, like, teach the kurawangs to share and share alike. Like in kindergarten class, get along with your playmates. We don't know how to do it. And I feed the kurawangs a lot. They like me. But they can't have exclusive ownership. So what's the point? I've seen that relationship go away, and we wish we could still feed on one. So anyway, that's is. And now I'm talking about a, you know, pet wild bird. What if it's your beloved bird and they die? You know, what if it's a close relative and they're gone? Or, you know, your significant other, and the relationship ends. It's painful. It hurts. Right? It hurts. The bodhisattva contemplates how all things that are conditioned are the same way. they are prone. Many disasters, Wuhan, just say they go away. They break up. Things break up. Okay, Connie? That's it. That was what I said. All right. So moving on. And furthermore, the Buddha says they have no nature of their own. Chapter is famous for, like, we always say, lifting the hood on the car universe. Many of us never lift the hood on our car. We put the key, even if it's electronic, we punch key, know where the steering wheel is, where the brakes are, the windows, the radio. That's it. That's all we need to know. We don't. Only the mechanic lifts the hood. The Buddha is saying, we're going to lift the hood on the car of the universe. Here's how it works. Get your mind dirty in the engine grease of the universe. What is he saying? This is the chapter that talks about the 12 links of conditioned arising, dependent co-arising, they call it. And those 12 links are the way things come into being and go out. That's what the Buddha is describing. It's a science text. It's a lab manual. He's saying things go from ignorance into being and die. 12 steps, and he tells us. He has done that. We're almost done with the sixth ground. He says he has proven in the last couple of lectures that even though they come into being, you could say underneath the appearance or inside the appearance, they exist at all. There's no single thing that says computer mouse in this. It's a component device, right? There is no single item here called teacup. But when you put it all together and the conditions are there, it's a teacup, only it's not known in the China teacup, it's a cafe, and in French it's some what, you know, and in other languages it's not a teacup, tea mug. So what's the reality, the nature of its own? So the Buddha is saying, here it is, and he's going, no, it's not. Here it is, all these conditioned things, they cause a lot of trouble, but guess what? Gone. They don't exist at all. Isn't that amazing? No. Oh, yeah. Yeah, kind. There's plenty of room to make a snappy answer there, and something's funny. I don't think I would, you know, say take an aspirin. I'm not a doctor. As a Dharma doctor, that would not be a responsible thing to say, so I need to, like, take your question seriously. And I hear the sincerity of your question. That's, every case is different. And it's kind of like, you know that story about the doctors who get so upset when people see them on the sidewalk and they go, hey, by the way, doctor, I got this pain. What should I do? And the doctor says, you know, take a Tylenol and mail in the $15. Mm-hmm. Or come to my office and, you know, I might consider checking out your health care insurance and then I might take you on as a patient. Don't ask me on the sidewalk. You know, doctors say that. People do. People come right up to the doctor and say, I got this pain here. Can you, you know, how to open a case and all that. So, yeah, what do you do, Connie? You're saying, what do you do when it hurts? Let me ask you, what do you do when it hurts? Suffer. Get it out. That's one solution. Work. That's an analog solution. Totally. That sometimes works. But it still hurts, right? The great Buddhist one-liner, it's a soundbite which you can use. It's a really good one. This is one of those things that floats Facebook occasionally, which is, it says, pain is inevitable, suffering is optional. That's a soundbite. Isn't that good? Pain is inevitable. In other words, things break up, Bodhisattva tells us, and we like things to stick around. We like to keep things, especially things we like. Unless we don't like it, then we wish it would go away faster. But we like things. When they break up, it hurts. Let's just talk about, you know, if you don't sleep for 2 nights. Go 2 nights without sleep and you feel terrible. You feel jet lagged. Every step is heavy and things are not happy in your heart. Things that usually give you pleasure, like a nice cup of tea, don't, because you've been awake. Okay. That's painful. When we get out of that pain, things go away, pain arises. However, here's the second half of that bumper sticker, right? Suffering is inevitable. Pain, suffering is optional. If you have a reason why it hurts, you don't necessarily suffer. A mom will stay up with her sick child as long as it takes. Right? She's not suffering. If somebody said to the mom who was up with her sick child, who was really sick, you know, a kid has measles, and measles is fatal, it'll kill you, but it hasn't for a long time because people get inoculated. So mom is there, the kid is, you know, got the bumps all over their body, and every movement is painful, and they can't eat, and they can't sleep, and they can't roar, and they can't, you know. And the mom does not say, this is really a pain, you know, I'm really irritated, this is such a, you're annoying me. It doesn't. Mom says, oh dear, does it hurt? However long it takes, it's painful to be up 48 hours with a sick child, it's not suffering for her. Her suffering is her worry for the child, but her own discomfort is not suffering. So, Connie, you get the point, right? So pain is inevitable because things break up, right? The suffering is optional. Yeah, thank you. You're right. I didn't say anything to your question. I didn't answer your question. Why are you thinking? So, yeah, I know. Good. You accomplished that goal. I know. You didn't want to tell the truth because, hey, wait a minute. You're not done yet. I'm not going to let you look at you. So, what do you do when it hurts? If you're like, if some end and you've been having a good time in summer and now it's got to go, you know. That's another kind of pain, and if a boyfriend away, that's another kind of pain, and if your mom scolded you and you got angry at her and used the wrong words, that's another kind of pain. So I can't give you like one answer to all the different kinds of pain. What do you do when it hurts? What do I do when it hurts is, first of all, check to see if it's physical. If it's because, you know, I overate and my stomach is bloated, that's one kind of problem. Is it mental? Am I suffering because somebody's, you know, said something bad about my songs online? You know, oh, we heard that monk, and, you know, it's just, what is a monk doing playing guitar anyway? Like, Buddhism is really coming to an end in America. Monks are playing guitar. That's another kind of thing, you know. That's a intellectual, like, oh, somebody insulted me. You know, my face hurts. Then if it's like I get discouraged about cultivation, my bad habits haven't changed after 40 years, I'm still stuck in the same bad habits, that's a spiritual kind of thing. Disease, you know, not at ease. So I have to use something different for that. So your question is a little too big to really give you like a definite answer. Your own answer was the best one, which is wait it out. Because why? It's going to change. One meditation class 2-3 weeks ago, I gave the Sinfu, the four things to keep in mind. So here's some Dharma medicine, right? Here's a good place to start. This not only cures the physical pain, well, physical is not... Still, Tylenol is best, or aspirin. But for intellectual and spiritual pain, these are really good medicines, which is what? One is you contemplate four things, just a way of looking. It's a contemplation. You look with your mind, not with your eyes only, right? What do you contemplate?
you contemplate how the body, shen bu jing, guan shen bu jing, you look at how your body is not clean, not pure, and it doesn't mean you're dirty. It's not that. It's that you recognize that the body is going to be a lasting source of pleasure. A bad hair day, you get pimples, your skin gets greasy, your, not your skin, but, you know, my skin. You get sick, you don't, you know, food doesn't taste good. When you age, oh my goodness, food really doesn't satisfy anymore. That's number one. Contemplate how the body is impure. Guan shou jie ku. You contemplate how sensations don't hit the spot. Right? Shou jie ku. Literal shou, that's the second anda, how your feelings, jie ku, don't satisfy. They're always changing. I felt happy for a while, but it didn't last. Right? I felt overheated. I took my shirt off. I took the upper layer of clothes. You know, you're always trying to adjust. I'm feeling instinct. They don't last. The Buddha said, look there. You'll see how you need to keep in balance. Then, number three, and this is the one that cued me into your question, xin wu chang. You contemplate how thoughts don't last. They rise and fall. You said wait it out, right? So what was miserable yesterday is now like, okay, I can handle it. I can live it. I adjusted it to it. Because why? It's not the same. It's different. Xin wu chang. Contemplate how thoughts rise and fall, rise and fall. In the book, the meditation, the mindfulness movement, there's this really great... There's a lot when I teach meditation, which is you realize that everything that rises in the mind ceases in the mind. I don't think I've ever seen that exactly in the Mahayana tradition. It's part of the Vipassana. It's true. Rises in the mind. If you watch long enough and you're really paying attention, you'll see even if it hurts, sometimes it hurts worse, you know, later, but it does change. And over time, it'll go away. So if you can be patient, then things improve. Then the last one. Okay, you still with me? I'm giving this the four stuff, right? Four things. This is Dharma medicine. So contemplate how your body is not pure. Contemplate how it won't satisfy because they don't last. Contemplate how thoughts are rising, falling. And the fourth one is, the very interesting one, this is ties into our sutra. You contemplate dharmas, things that are constructed, have no, there's no nature inside anything that you can find, that you can grab. True. So the Buddha said these will help, four contemplations. What are they? They're just ways of looking at it. I've known people who did impossible things because their minds were strong. Doctors, Ebola territory. There's a story about Ebola. Ebola, we don't hear about it anymore. Fox News has decided that we're not all going to die of Ebola, so they took it off the air. There was a time when Fox News was, you know, scaring everybody. So this one of the stories that isn't anymore was huge movement of medical people into West Africa. They're the volunteers for people who because of the, you know, they were moved by compassion. Doctors Without Borders, Médecins Sans Frontières. They went in huge numbers to Africa to volunteer with the Ebola crisis. And, you know, what does it take to know that death is right there, and yet you're still going into moved by the suffering of people. Incredible, you know. So that's a way of looking. They're in the middle of suffering, but they don't see it as or terrifying, and so they whine. Other people go, how could you do that? And their answer is, how could you not? People, let's not go to Ebola. Let's just say your local dog shelter, the ASPCA. What is it in Australia? RSPCA, the Royal Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. Going in makes the lives of the dogs and cats brighter. We talked a lot today about animal suffering, and there's anybody who's been a veterinarian or an assistant knows that a lot of the business of euthanasia, animal shelters. Some are no-kill shelters, and the dogs are there for a year. I was reading the other day about somebody who does exactly that. They're a volunteer dog shelter in Utah, and they have black dogs are adopted last. Black dogs, people don't pick them up. They don't make them fan. Something about the color and black cats. So this person had known some of these dogs waiting for a year, and they became best friends with them. So how nice to be able to go and brighten the lives of these wonderful, you know, creatures, animals, who are just waiting for a human to belong to and go be kind to them. This is a great story. This one woman was a photographer. She had a gift with captioning. She said, this is the animal in a photograph. And Kai, you're sitting there. Put your Nikon. Get your big Nikons out. Go to the local animal shelter and set up your tripod. And she had a way she would hold a treat. She'd get the dog's attention with a treat, give him a couple. Then she would lift the treat up, and the dog would look up into the lens, and she would go click. And then she would post immediately, this dog is available. And she was able to capture right through the dog into the soul of the animal, and these dogs went out of the shelters. So people would call in and say, hey, that one, what's her name, Spot? Is she still there? I want to come get her, you know. She would post it on the internet, these pictures that she used, her time, her energy, pictures of the animals waiting for adoption, and it worked. So this one little, was it Utah or Wyoming? This one little animal shelter in Wyoming had the highest rate for most of the Western states, you know, because this photographer used lovable pictures online that she did it entirely on her own, you know. So in the midst of, Bodhisattva says, they have no nature of their own. So I understand that things fall apart, but in the middle of that, I still, through kindness and compassion, find a way to bring warmth to a very caring conglomeration of conditions, accumulation of conditions. These dharmas are not produced and not destroyed. They're simply just like what? Just like energy and matter. It becomes matter, matter becomes energy. Is there more or less of it? No, it's just a regrouping when the conditioning. Yet, the bodhisattva constantly gives rise to great compassion and doesn't forsake sentient beings. Key here. Bodhisattva says, you know what? There's nothing going on. There's no self anywhere. I'm out of here. Bye. What kind of a crazy play is this? Why are we all dancing around in the middle of nothing having anything that lasts? You know, that would be... Yes, yes. Okay, who's speaking? What's your name? Okay, hi, Tajima. Tajima, go ahead. Okay.
Words. And is there anything here that's more than you know, if you don't realize that things are conditioned, then you will suffer. Is he pointing to any other danger, anything else other than that?
Oh. Okay. Cool. Okay. I appreciate your question because you're asking about the translation. Liver at the Chinese, there's that first line. You see the words guo huan, G-U-O-H-U-A-N? That's like, if you start on the right side as characters, number four. Okay, those are the two Chinese words that, when translated, became false and disastrous. You know what I did when I explained it was I rephrased it. I said, things fall apart. That was intentional. To answer precisely the question you're raising, which is, why is it false and disastrous? Does it have to be false and disastrous? Okay, understand, first of all, this was originally Sanskrit. Okay, translation number one out of Sanskrit in the Chinese. We're doing translation number two out of Chinese into English. Okay, so do you want to know, to say what was the original? I can't answer that one because I don't have the manuscript with me. But the Chinese that we got is guo huan, two fourth tones. And before that is the pluralizer. It's duozhu, lots of guo huan. So we take the Chinese, we put it into English. Does it have to be two things, is your question? Not at all. Yeah, go ahead.
Is there? When I read faults and disasters, I'm thinking, is there anything other than suffering that is being pointed to here? You know, if you
Yeah, go ahead.
The intent of what is being said, rather than the translation.
Okay. Put it into context. Right? Be patient now. Let me answer. Okay. So the context is that's the first half of the bigger idea. Is what? It says in that way. In what way? Bodhisattva in that way. We've been spending weeks now having in the voice of the speaker, you know, the one who's explaining the text. He's been unpacking phenomena. Stuff that we encounter with our eyes, our ears, our nose, our tongue, our body, and our mind. He's been going deeply, deeply into them the way a scientist would, in a very analytical way, showing the component parts of experience. That's what we've been studying. And we always talk about it like, you know, like a doc, a manual for, you know, repairing your lawnmower or your computer, because that's the way it's been presented. So here is kind of the summary. We've reached the summary point. And we've had 10 explanations of 12 links. It's been very detailed. Okay? So you've come in at the summary part. So he says, the bodhisattva in that way, meaning feeling, seeing how things are not what they seem on the surface, and understanding that living beings, and that's the key talk. He's from the point of view of ordinary folks, and you can your mother's face there, or your best friend's face, or your children's face if you've got kids, someone you care about. From their point of view, they don't see into it, they only know to react when it changes. Okay, so that's the context. He says, from the point of view of as we look at things that are conditioned, i.e. my body, the world around me, the planet, with climate change, I see how it's breaking up for many disasters. And understanding that, looking more deeply into it, it's not breaking up. It's only conditions coming together. The bodhisattva sees it's temporary. He sees that there's nobody owns it. It's no part of any plan. It's not God's will, not fate or luck or chance, right? It's mechanical. We could even say that, what the sutra says, but that's why this is a process. Things coming together, temporarily adhering, and then changing. And there's nothing going on underneath that. But the guo huan, the faults and disasters, is that the people he cares about, those who keep him here in the world when he could leave, don't know that. They don't get that things, by their nature, don't last. And so he is trying to wake them up to that. He constantly gives rise to great compassion, and he doesn't go away. He doesn't forsake sentient beings. So that's the... And if you contextualize it, does that help? Does that make more sense of it? Yes? No?
Don't be polite.
Okay. Would you, let's see, all the bathrooms in the Singapore airport, when I finish drying my hands, they want me to rate the service in the bathroom. Did you know that? In KL, the same. You just take a towel, you dry your hands, and they right there. 5 stars, very satisfied. So please, you can rate my answer. 5-star answer. There we go. The key to this, and what I think this is so cool, is it says, once he knows stuff apart, we don't. So he sticks around until we get it. That's the sentence we haven't touched yet. Describing a bodhisattva, he's there to teach us until we wake up. He understands it's not going to last. We don't. We attach to it. It breaks. We hurt. He goes, okay, I'll try again. And right then, prajna paramita manifests before him, which is called the code language. This is code language. What does it mean? Prajna paramita is wisdom that crosses over. The wisdom, the bridge that takes you from not understanding all the way over to I get it. It's wisdom that allows you to do that. And so he sees at this point why he knows it's going to fall apart. He wants us to wait. She vows, until we get it. When you do an actual change, your wisdom grows. Prajna is the ability to see through the surface and understand the mechanics of it and the way to explain it so that people get it. And it's a light of wisdom. So something magical just happened in this paragraph, which is because the bodhisattva said, man, this is deep stuff, but I'm determined to stick around until I understand it, he gets help. This prajna paramita is a change in his mind, in her mind, and now he can say it in a way that people get it. So is that Feta? Feta?
Sorry, no, this is Yuanlin. I had a question, but maybe go ahead.
Go with your question. I was done.
Question is, you know, is feeling bad about, say, things that are going on in the world, I mean, in some form, is that attachment? Because it seems that, you know, yes, one knows that things fall apart, and they'll fall apart in different ways, but I'm just thinking back to all the people in the past who, you know, they felt bad about something and then they worked really hard to do something about it. If they had instead just kind of sat and observed, do you see what I'm...
I know you've been sitting there faithfully at the... Yuanlin is putting us online tonight, putting us on YouTube. You've listened to what I've said tonight, and I've said all kinds of all kinds of distressing things about, you know, from refugees to elephants disappearing to species in 4 years, you know, 60%, etc., climate change. And I didn't intend to do that. I wasn't determined tonight to bum everybody out, to give you more information than you can process, but it seems like I've done that. So what did I have in mind? As apropos your question, there's no one answer. It depends on your capacity for bad news. Some people, I remember when I was a freshman in college. It was my first year in university in a small liberal arts school in Michigan. And I had just become a vegetarian, full-time, completely. I'd been playing with it. This is 97. Okay, it tells you how old I am. And so I was now a full-time vegetarian. And I came back for Thanksgiving break. And you know how, like, our friend Brian Conroy, our storytelling teacher, Brian has seen on where he says there's nobody more insufferable than a new vegetarian. Right? They are self-righteous to the extreme and irritating. And so that was me. That was exactly me. And I had grown a beard. Okay, so I came home for Thanksgiving, and my dad took a look at my beard, and he's like, what's that? And so I said, it's a beard. You ever see one before? You know, it's like, I'm tough. I'm showing my independence, right? And it's Thanksgiving dinner, and I was a brand new vegetarian, and the turkey came. And so my dad, we had an electric knife, you know, cutting up the turkey. And I made some sort of, like, obnoxious remark about I didn't share my Thanksgiving dinner with a dead body on the table. And my father threw me out. He actually picked me up and threw me out into the snow on November 24th, 26th, and Thanksgiving. He actually threw me out of the house, and I was shocked. I'd never been, you know, picked up and thrown out of the house by father before. And I had it coming, man. But it's like, to answer Ian's question, how much can you stand? How much awareness can you stand? I think my answer to that question is, when I read these incredibly disturbing statistics about how fast our world is going away, and we've known all along, part of me is motivated to do something about it. Part of me uses Guanyin Bodhisattva's name or whatever dharma I'm called to create goodness, to try to change things. Part of me asks the question, how much of it is my that I cause? So my first response is to look inside, knowing what I'm part of, living being on the planet. I'm a white male in a complicated world. What's my share of the cause? And if I can change that, that's not nothing. That's significant. Better to change my own behavior than to shake a fist at the ones who are causing the trouble. So, and then my, how much can you take before you need to get active? And my rough interview, be more aware. Are we no? Are we? How could we not know that our behavior has altered the balance? I remember I was a brand new monk. I was like 26, coming back. I'd been a monk for 2 years. I was driving back from Santa Rosa. We came over the Marin Hills and across Golden Gate Bridge to go into San Francisco to Golden Mountain Monastery. And we were just coming out of the tunnel, and all of the San Francisco Bay Area was covered with this dirt haze. Felt it was a Friday night, and electric, but in a bad way. It was a positive electricity, not meaning happy positive, but positive ion charge. And it felt, and I knew that the something about San Francisco's pollution at the time, it's worse than it is now, I think, was going to change things. Because we were going into it, and it was unhealthy, and it was, I remember remarking on that, why was the air red? Why was the air over San Francisco red? It shouldn't have been. And you go to the weather in Beijing, you've seen the pictures in Beijing where the sky beside you is invisible because it's all white. The air is so thick and white you can't see the next door skyscraper. then the weather changes and the wind blows the pollution away, and oh, there's a skyscraper right there, 38 floors. It was there all along. The air was so thick I could see it. You know, not to single out Beijing. Beijing has always had problems with pollution because the soil from the north Gobi Desert blows in. And there's Beijing where it was always bad, but it's worse now than it caused pollution. The Chinese are trying hard to do something about it. Good for them. Chinese are leading the way now in terms of pollution solutions. Just to say, you pay attention to stuff, and at a certain point, you can't. My solution is to find my share of the cause if I can't change them. Does that help? Does that make sense?
Yes, thanks, and that was helpful.
What do you do? I mean, it's not. I'm not answering questions. I'm entering in a conversation. What, you know? What do you do when you see all the troubles in the world?
I think in the past, offline. I think in the past I tried to, in some cases, you know, do some, be active, quote unquote, but
not all of this
was, I guess, planned. But the way I seem to be going is more towards turning inward. I think, I guess there's a realization that you can only do so much kind of working externally. It's sometimes it seems like a drop in the ocean.
Yeah. Right, and yet a drop in the ocean is made from drops. One thing that I do is I don't kill animals to eat. A lot of the problems in the world have to do with the hatred that arises from killing. And I body on nutrients that are lower down the food chain. That's one. Meat is very intensive. Water required to create 1 pound of ground beef is about 100 or 150 times more than the amount of water required to create the equivalent weight in apples or wheat or berries or peas. So simply by eating less meat, 10% less, we could positively impact climate change. There's no doubt that the number one cause of greenhouse gases is large animal farming, livestock farming. That's one. Another thing that the monks and nuns do following our teaching is we 3 hours a day. And every day. And we eat once a day, and we get along. You know, it's not, Master Hua would say, my desire loss when it comes to food, he would say. He would say that we take a loss in on our tongue as being my master was a master in the future, well, we get a benefit later. But anyway, so that's to say that's one thing you can do is look at our food habits. How much do we need to get along? And if we can, you know, save that much resources for others, positive. That's something active to do. Refusing to get angry would be a big, big change. Simply refusing to let fire come out of my nature would be a big, big change. How about that? Boy, that would be tough. That's a soul sacrifice, right? To not be able to blast anybody, even when they richly deserve it, you dirty son of a bird, right? So to be able to do that, just remove anger that much, it's huge. I actually think that by changing a sign or writing a letter, you're changing anybody. Much better change yourself. It's real. And it's a small piece, but it's a real piece. So those are things you can do that are right within the purview of Buddhist practice. Look at your intake of things in the world. See if you can reduce it. And you give by reducing your share. That's one. Sure that your behavior doesn't cause suffering for others. Gossip less, man. Gossip evil. They say, not passing on gossip is liberation. I was just hearing from a friend in a camp, and somebody was out to slander this person. And she, at the end of the camp, she was told by another teacher how much poison was put in the air by this jealous individual. One person's mouth caused all this incredible suffering in a week among campers, just by one person deliberately going out to mouth. So just think about what we can pull back from the planet. In terms of slander and gossip and the hatred that comes from being killed for food. And actually, there's lots and lots and lots we can do that only requires us to refrain. It's not that we have to go out and do something more. It's by not doing the things that we do. Killing, stealing, lying, gossiping, slandering. You know. So the precepts are the most ecologically active behavior changes, I think, you can find in the world. If you really want to be proactive, then refuse to take part in things that humans do, stealing, lusting, lying, and drug use. That is incredibly active as an activist, right? Doesn't have to be like finding a good cause to get involved in. To remove that much poison from the planet, done a huge thing. Right? Yes, no? Everybody's looking at their feet. What do you mean next? I don't want to. Okay. Time to transfer the merit.
YouTube question.
I was going to. Yes, the YouTube question. Tell them it's too late. Come next week. Okay. I was. One of the things I had in mind to do was. Somebody mentioned. They enjoyed the song Master Empty Cloud Wakes Up, the hybrid Chinese English song Bei Zi Pu Luo Di Xiang Li Li Shuang Sui Ye Quang Xing Chang Xia Xie Bei Zi Pu Xiang Shuang Ling Ling Li. They said it was Chinese English hybrid song. So I'm trying to do that. One of the ones that I'm working on is this one. Been working on it for a bunch of years. It's Yongjia Da Shi Zheng Dao Ge, Master Yongjia's Song of Enlightenment, Song of Awakening. This is a real song. It's a song meant to be sung. 62 verses. Ha, ha. 2 verses. And it translates really well into English. Can you sing it, is the question. So I've been working actually with Jody Stecker and with Peter Rowan. The Peter Rowan actually gave me a version of this. And one of our folklore heroes, Jody Stecker in the Bay Area, gave me some hints about how to, the Tang Dynasty song meant to be sung. And we found the... there's a song called The Blind Fiddler. It's a British folk song. Let's see. Where did it go? Something like this. And I was going to introduce it tonight and show it as a work in progress, but we're out of time. I'm just going to give you a preview of coming attractions and see if we can get some. I'd love to have this done and available. It goes, Dan De Ban, Wu Qiu Mo. Let's see, about Qing Jing Liu Li Han Bao Yue, Ji Neng Jie Ci Ru Yi Chu, Zi Li Li Ta Zhong Bu Jie. It's talking about the mind. This is the mind. It goes like this. When you get the root, you can the branch tips be like a jeweled moon that shines in lapis lazuli. Now that you understood this wish fulfilling him, your new self enters. Truly never. The Mani Pearl Mansoba the mind, right? Bao Zhu. Moni Zhu Renbu Shi Rulai Zhang Xing Rulai Zhang Li Qin Shou De Liu Ban Shen Yong Kong Bu Kong Yi Ke Yuan Guang. That's how the Chinese goes. So it's talking, right? This is the energy for the mind. This is the money pearl, a treasure still unknown. Look to the Tathagata, but find it on your own. It works in six uncanny ways, here and now it's gone. With light, so I can finish them. Next week, we'll start four. Thank you all, Julia, Tori, and Jim. Dedicate the merit. You got it there in your songbook. I'm going to bring it here for our single post. 1 second. Jin He Shi, what do you think? Are you encouraged? Was this an okay experience of technologically?
Was, I think, good, but technically the audio wasn't that great tonight. As in
okay.
Every maybe 5 or 6, 5 or 8 words, one word would drop.
No wonder you weren't laughing at my jokes. Oh, man. I thought it was my problem. Okay. Work done. Work in progress. Okay. Please make a wish for animals, for our own future. Here we go. As one radiant with life, share the fruits of peace with hearts of goodness, luminous and bright. If we hear and see our hands can find in giving you the tea. May their minds awake to great compassion, wisdom, and to joy. May kindness find reward, may all sorrow be their grief and grief. May the pointless life spell the darkness of their endless night. Because our hearts are one, this world of pain turns into paradise. May all become compassionate and wise. May all become compassionate. Okay, Jin Fo Shi, do you want to lead everybody? Yao Ling Da Jia Li Fo, huh? Li Fo San Bai, huh? Woman Ziji Bai Ziji. Nikoi Dai Da Jia Li Fo, how about?
Hong Shi?
Go ahead.
Okay, yep. Just to let everybody know, next week in Berkeley, we'll have the Ulambana ceremony. And so what we're going to do is we're going to have it in the morning. So we'll have the Ulambana ceremony at 9 o'clock in the morning, 9 to 10:30. In the afternoon, there'll be the memorial service at 1:30. So if you could let your friends know.
What day are we talking about?
This next week.
What
next,
day?
That's August 29th.
Next week.
August 29th, Saturday. So next Saturday, we'll have the Ulambana ceremony. and in the morning at 9 o'clock. So just want to let people know and let your friends know. Okay, that's it.
Okay, thank you. So, Jinfo Shi, ni dai da jia di fo, huh? Can we ask Jinfo Shi to lead everybody in bowing in Berkeley, and we'll see you all next week.
Okay. Amitabha. Okay.